Between the oversimplified definitions and the intimidating math, the concept of calculus is often lost somewhere in between. And it's a real shame because if you understand it, the concept of calculus is very interesting and applicable across many different fields such as physics, biology, and economics. The intent of this video is to integrate, no pun intended, the concepts of both differential and integral calculus visually with some of the math and equations that go along with it. For those who are taking calculus or are planning to, understanding the concepts of calculus not only helps you answer questions that are more conceptually based, but it can also help you understand why you do the certain mathematical steps that you do in calculus. All right, let's go. Much like how geometry is a branch of mathematics that focuses on properties of shapes, and algebra is a branch of mathematics that focuses on the manipulation of equations and variables, calculus is just another branch of math, except it's a bit different than all the other types of math because calculus deals with continuous change. In other words, dynamic math. This video will clarify just what that means and how that applies to the two main branches of calculus. The majority of topics in math are static, or in other words, they are constant. Here's what I mean. If you see a rectangular prism, would you be able to find the volume? Or how about finding the side length or angle within this triangle? Or the slope of this linear function? Or the area underneath this linear function? The answer to all those questions is yes, if you're provided with sufficient information. Hell, worst comes to worst, if drawn to scale, you can take out a ruler or a protractor and measure the values yourself. What do all of these have in common? Well, for one, they are all linear. They're made up of straight lines only. Okay. What about these shapes? Can you find the volumes and areas of these shapes? And again, the answer is yes, thanks to the magic number we refer to as pi. Thanks to pi, we have actual equations and formulas available to calculate the volumes and areas of these round shapes. So essentially, static constant math revolves around linearized information when it comes to finding slopes, areas, and volumes. And to find volumes and areas of nonlinear shapes, they would have to be normal or regular shapes with existing equations. In other words, in static math, all the information is already there. Now, it doesn't mean it's easy as 1 plus 1. You might need to do a lot of numbers crunching or using some critical thinking, but you won't need to find loopholes to answer questions, such as theorizing or looking for trends. Let's take a look at the linear function and its slope again. For linear functions, the slope is always constant. So as long as you're provided with the coordinates of at least 2 points, or hell, you can just measure the rise and run yourself, you should be able to find the average slope of the function. But what about for higher order curved functions? Since the slope is always changing from point to point, how would you find the slope of a particular point on a curve? Recall, the slope is the same thing as the rate of change, the key word here being change. And in order to calculate the rate of change, there first has to be change, which means we will need to go from one point to another point, and that's why the slope equation has two sets of coordinates. So in terms of static math, it is impossible to find the slope at a particular point on a curve. Sure, even if they provide you with coordinates of another point. The line you make between the points would have varying slopes, none of which is similar to the slope of the point that we want. In theory, we can make a tangent line, which touches only our point along the curve, and find its slope because the slope of a tangent line is the same as the slope of that particular point that the tangent line is touching. But how on earth are we supposed to draw a perfect tangent line? It's impossible. So obviously, it's impossible to use static math to help us find the slope at a particular point, and this is where calculus comes in. More specifically, the first branch of calculus known as differential calculus. In most areas in North America, it is taught under the course named Calculus 1. The goal of differential calculus is to find the instantaneous rate of change. In other words, it's to find the slope at any particular point along the curve. I'll go over how it does that in just 1 second. But since we're here, let's uncover the second branch of calculus. First, let's revisit the area underneath our linear function. As you can see, the area highlighted in yellow is a triangle. So as long as we have some coordinates and data, we can easily find the highlighted area using the equation to find areas of triangles, which is half times base times height. Even if the shape that we want to find the area for is not a simple triangle or rectangle as shown here, we can easily break it down into smaller components, both of which are, again, simple shapes with simple equations that we already know. But what if our function isn't linear, but rather a curve? And I want to find the area of this irregular shape underneath our curve. Static math has failed us again, because there's no equation for this irregular shape. And no matter how many coordinates it gives us, we won't be able to accurately and reliably find the area we would have to estimate to some degree. Well, the second branch of calculus, integral calculus, also known as calculus 2 here in North America, tackles this exact problem. Integral calculus focuses on finding the accumulated area for 2 dimensions and volume for 3D underneath a curve. So the million-dollar question, how? And the answer is simple. We use something called limits. Arguably, limits is the fundamental principle in calculus as it allows us to think dynamically and not statically. When we use the limit, it lowers the significance of us knowing the exact coordinates of a point. Actually, it lowers the significance of the point entirely. Instead, the concept of limits puts heavy emphasis on the patterns established when something infinitely approaches a value. And since approaching infinity isn't something that actually happens, it's technically impossible from a static math point of view, it opens up the door for us to use loopholes by theorizing or looking for trends and, most importantly, continuous change. Suppose I know the x-coordinate of this point is 4, but I don't know the y-coordinate. And suppose I can see the values of x and y given on this table here. So by looking at the table of values, it's pretty evident that when x is 4, y is probably 2. Again, this is a simplified example. In the actual chapter of limits, when you learn this in calculus, we can't always make that assumption as a graph because it could be discontinuous at that region. For now, let's not get into that. So for this example, we can write it as the limit when x approaches 4 is 2. That means as our x value gets infinitely closer to 4, the y value gets infinitely closer to 2. But we don't really even know if there is a point that's 4, 2. It's purely based on the pattern. So how does differential calculus exploit this concept of limits in trying to find the slope at a particular point on this curve? Well, first off, there's no way around the fact that we need 2 points to find the slope of anything, since the equation of slope demands 2 sets of coordinates. Fine, since we're interested in the slope of the y point, let's arbitrarily set a green point right here. Now that we have 2 points, and we can find the slope between the 2 points shown by the purple line right here. But does this accurately depict the slope of our point of interest represented by the imaginary green tangent line? Not at all. The 2 lines are definitely different, and the slopes of these 2 lines, I can guarantee you, are very different as well. So what do we do now? Well, hold on. When I arbitrarily plotted the green point, I plotted it quite far away from our original point of interest. What if I moved the second point closer to my point of interest? As you can see, the slope of the line between the 2 points is now very similar to the slope of the imaginary tangent line to the point of our interest. But why stop there? In theory, couldn't the green point move infinitely closer to my original point? We're talking microscopically closer, at the atomic level, subatomic level even. And the answer is yes, of course. And that's where limit comes in. The limit as h approaches 0, don't worry about what h approaching 0 represents. That's covered in great depth in my video on the definition of the derivative. It represents the idea that our 2 points are getting infinitely closer. The right half of the equation just represents the slope equation between the 2 points. Together, this is known as the definition of the derivative, and it is the logical basis of differential calculus and how we can find the slope at any given point. That is, we theoretically use another point that is infinitely close to it. That way, we abide by the rules of finding slope in that we have 2 points, but we get them so close together that the slope between the 2 points is pretty much the same as the slope of our single point. Okay, but what about integral calculus? How can we manipulate the concept of limits to help us find areas underneath curves? Let's revisit this weird shape underneath our curve. Again, there's no equation for this shape. So, what can we do? Well, let's use a shape that we do have an equation for, the rectangle. Let's say I make a rectangle right here. Does the area of this rectangle accurately resemble the area of the weird red shape? Not really. It includes its entire green region that isn't a part of the red shape, and it misses the entire purple area that is a part of our shape of interest. Okay, what if I use 3 rectangles, all with the same width, but different heights? Still, it's not great, but you can see it's an improvement over just using one rectangle. In fact, as we extrapolate this pattern, it would make sense that the more rectangles we can make within the shape, we can tailor the heights of each rectangle so that it more accurately represents the shape of interest. In other words, the more rectangles we make, when we add up the areas of all our rectangles, it will be more and more similar to the actual area of our irregular weird shape. And this is where limit comes in again. The right-hand side of the expression is just representing the sum of the areas of each rectangle. The big E you see represents a sum, and f of x times delta x is just another way of showing length times width of each rectangle. The limit as n approaches infinity represents the fact that we want infinitely more rectangles. How many rectangles can we possibly fit in this shape? The answer is infinite. We can make rectangles infinitely thin so we can squeeze as many rectangles in this shape as we possibly can. This is known as the definition of the integral, the foundation of integral calculus in our attempt to find areas of weird shapes underneath curves. Looking at it now, it's clear that limits play critical roles in both branches of calculus, and it's also the reason why calculus is considered dynamic math with constant change. It's because we're always approaching infinity instead of just accepting a number for what it is. One final note to bring this video full circle. Being the two branches of calculus, differential calculus and integral calculus are actually very closely related. I know, it's weird, right? How is finding the slope in any way related to finding areas and volume? Let's see here. Suppose we have a function denoted as f of x. If we were to differentiate it, we would find f prime of x, also known as a derivative, which is a function that helps us find the slope at any particular point on the original function f of x. This is essentially differential calculus. Starting at the original f of x again, this time, if we integrate it, we would get capital f of x, also known as the antiderivative. The antiderivative is a function that helps us find the accumulated area underneath our original function f of x. And this would be a part of integral calculus, of course. Okay, but what if I don't start at f of x necessarily? Again, sure, I know when I differentiate f of x, I would end up with f prime of x, which is the derivative of f of x. But what if I differentiate capital f of x, pretending it's my original function? Then would an f of x be the derivative of my original function capital f of x? In other words, anytime we're moving downwards here on the screen, we're finding the derivative of the previous function above. Same thing for integration. Sure, I know when I integrate f of x, I will get the antiderivative capital f of x. But what if I integrate f prime of x, pretending it's my original function? Then in this case, f of x would be the antiderivative of my original function f prime of x. In other words, anytime we're moving upwards on the screen by integration, we're finding the antiderivative of the previous function below. So as you can see, differentiation and integration are exact opposites of each other. So at the end of the day, differential calculus and integral calculus are inverses of each other, and this is known as the fundamental theorem of calculus. While it sounds like something you would learn right at the beginning of calculus, it's actually almost always taught sometime during calculus 2 after the introduction of integration.
If you like this video, consider subscribing to my YouTube channel and also follow me on my other social media platforms.